It's the official podcast, and it's back and better than ever. Andrew and I got back from a wedding. Do you guys want to say congrats to us?
Congratulations, congrats. You two.
Thank you.
Really happy that it worked out.
No, we attended a wedding together.
It was very nice. I rarely get to attend weddings, even though I go to like one every two fucking months because I'm at that age. But it was still nice. I still felt like I achieved something.
Yeah, it was nice. It was Matt's wedding. He and Monique got married after 9 years. And Andrew and I went to the ceremony. We got some good food. We busted some good dance moves. It was a very nice time.
It was.
How late did you stay out?
Oh, man, we partied till like the break of dawn. I didn't leave until like 10:30, and that's ridiculous. That's crazy.
That's pretty late. Yeah, that's pretty late. How long do weddings usually go for? It's been a while since I've been to a wedding.
Yeah, they don't go super long.
You've got the wedding ceremony, but then you've got like the whatever the like after party. What is it called? Like the reception. Right? Yeah.
Typically, those go till you run out of time on the venue. Like the venue gives you so many hours to be there, and then they kick you out.
Oh, right. Yeah. Yeah, that makes sense. But wouldn't the fucking? I mean, I think like historically maybe. Wouldn't the couple want the wedding to be over as quickly as possible so they finally have sex for the first time?
Oh, yeah. That's a good point.
Yeah, you might be onto something.
Very old.
Weddings used to be a much more casual affair back in the day where it was literally, hey, you want to get married? And then you'd go to the courthouse and file a marriage document. It wasn't like this big, huge deal outside of your family and closest friends, but... I don't know when the tradition started. I think it was the Victorian era because of Queen Victoria having a lavish wedding when it became, hey, why doesn't everyone have a big lavish wedding where you throw a party and impress people with your wealth and shit?
Oh, wait, so before that, it wasn't like an actual extravagant affair that people would...
I think it probably was
because it was like one and done for life.
I'm paraphrasing other educational YouTubers I watched, but basically before some time, it was either a queen or a major historical figure. Weddings were a celebration, but they weren't like this giant extravagant ceremony with crazy shit. And then after that, everyone was like, well, I want that. I want to be the queen. I want to be the big honcho. So then it became like all these traditions on top of traditions on top of traditions.
Or is it more likely that people just didn't have the means to put on a celebration of that, like those kinds of scales before, like the Industrial Revolution or whatever, when people started making actual money and having assets and stuff? Like, sure, like peasant farmers weren't going to put on extravagant weddings because they just didn't have the means to. I assume there were always these kind of large royal weddings historically throughout time.
Yeah, I imagine that like the upper echelon used to have big.
Oh, yeah. Of course. I'm talking about the common man. I'm not talking about royalty. They were probably from the get-go doing this crazy shit.
How true is the information that lords used to be able to fuck your wife on the wedding night? That they got, like, first dibs to your bride before you got to fuck her?
No, that's Reddit.
First I've heard of that.
Yeah. You've browsed too many subs.
I swear it was an actual thing though. Yeah, see, someone said it was a thing. It was called Prima Nocta. Or is that a Final Fantasy character?
I found what you were looking for, Jackson, on the world famous Wikipedia. In the 19th century, weddings were typically small, intimate ceremonies at home of either the parents of the bride or the parents of the groom. Their wedding announcement took place at church the following Sunday. In the 1820s and 30s, weddings became more elaborate when upper-class couples had wedding ceremonies similar to modern customs. So that's when, like, the brides would wear their best dress and like, things started getting more elaborate. So it wasn't until, like, the 1800s when weddings really started to become this gigantic thing. But before that, it was just simple, hey, let's get married. Our parents are right there. They can do it for us.
I mean, I'm pretty sure weddings were just throughout history and multiple cultures just celebrated. Probably the whole village and everything.
Oh, yeah.
you'd get a wedding invitation back in the medieval dark ages, and you'd like roll your eyes and be like, fuck, there goes yeah, Sunday
please
night.
RSVP.
The modern whole like giant procession reception and all that shit, that's more modern than we think. But you know, I bet you if people got married back then, everyone was still excited. They might still have thrown a party, might have still, you know, been happy about it, but well, I don't know.
Again, like the yeah. Lord would have been happy. This prima nocta thing is an actual thing. It's the legal right of a monarch to have sex with any female subject, particularly on her wedding night. It's an actual thing.
Yeah, but Jackson, that's just called that's rape. So crazy. Of course, that's always been a thing. That's like well, Saddam's sons used to do that, where they would literally kidnap brides on their wedding night and gang rape the bride. That's not like a...
Yeah, but this...
It's the law that this is good and we get to do this. It's just called power. This,
yeah.
It's might over rights.
No, wrong. It's prima nocta.
Going along as well cooler. With that, I think another angle we're not considering is a lot of weddings in the past used to be totally arranged. Like, completely arranged. Like, when you had royal weddings, it was, hey, you're marrying this guy. You don't want to? Too bad. You marry this guy. That's it. You're done. So, I don't think they'd want to celebrate it a lot of the time. It was just kind of, hey, I have to.
Would you guys prefer to be a lord during that time period or a prince in this time period?
Can I be a lord in this back time then, period?
Like, well, no, it's like the same thing. Like, you know, a person of like royal status. Like it meant something back then, but then now you still have like the creature comforts of being like ultra wealthy in this time period.
Yeah, I mean, there's still a, it's still a nice gig to be a prince in this timeline. No obligations, you just sit around.
I don't think prima nocta is like endorsed anymore, so weddings are useless for you at the moment.
Is it not?
But back
last time I checked, that royal family was embroiled in all the Epstein shit, so I don't know about that. But I don't know, I feel like being a prince would still be a sweet gig. I know once in a while they still complain about what a tough life they have because they have to attend a boring ceremony while holding a golden egg and
all the weddings.
This is such a tough life, but
they have to go to so many weddings.
Oh, boo-hoo.
Oh, God. Free parties.
Oh, good food.
They have to go to all these weddings that the commoners pay for.
On their dime? Ugh, God.
What do you do for a living? I have to wear gold and eat cake.
It's wedding crashers, but back then.
Yeah.
Royalty back then would have been sweet. Can you imagine being a king back then? And everyone just worships you like a god and gives you everything that you want in every capacity. That'd be fucking
nuts.
Yeah,
until you did something wrong.
You don't do any cool stuff like play video games, though, because it's too early for that.
Oh, fuck, you're right.
That's what I meant. Like, it meant something back then, but you're still, like, shitting in a pot at the end of the night. Like, you're still in that time period. It's fucking awful.
People watching you get up in the morning, it's fucking weird. It's strange.
Oh, yeah, that's definitely why living today is like, even peasants today, us, we live more lavish and comfy lives than kings back then. Just having nice toilets and sanitary conditions and like electricity.
Food too, better food.
Food, yeah. All sorts of food from all around the fucking planet. Especially if you're a prince, just have a private chef. No, yeah, I'd want to be a prince.
You could get invaded by like Genghis Khan at any given time, or you like your own.
Well, that can still happen today.
Revolt and like cut off your head. He could come back.
He could come back.
There was a non-zero chance.
I still prefer now. I'd prefer to be a peasant in this time period than royalty back then, probably.
Yeah,
because like Charlie said, video games.
That's true.
Just video games, that's why.
Yeah, just video games.
Just video games. You can make your own games back then. I mean, you can just command your peasants to play for you, like chess pieces.
Yeah, but that's kind of boring.
Right.
Yeah, unless it's on a screen.
Jackson, would you rather be a lord back then or prince right now? The singer-songwriter prince.
Singer? Is he still alive?
No, but let's pretend he is.
Oh, okay. Well, if he was alive right now, definitely prince.
Well, yeah.
Absolutely. Fucking, that's better than being royalty, because the people that are worshipping you actually like you and want to worship you. Royalty, it's never the case that people actually like the royalty. It's just that they're born into a family that commands respect to some degree. So
very true.
I would want to be liked for being liked.
Oh.
Oh. You want to be the nice king.
Yeah, I do. So wedding, that was very nice. Did it get you guys at all feeling clucky? Do you see marriage in your future at all?
Feeling clucky?
I don't know what that word was that you...
You don't know what clucky means?
Is this Australia slang?
Is it Australian slang? I don't know. I thought it just meant like in the mood for marriage, basically.
The only time I've heard getting clucky is when someone's making a joke on getting lucky. That's about it.
I've never heard that either. But wait. Are you telling me that clucky, like it in Australian slang, translates to being excited for marriage specifically?
No, it's usually used for like having babies.
Yeah, it means baby fever in Australian, apparently. Clucky.
Unfortunately, Jackson, according to dictionary.com, clucky is Australian informal. It's Australian informal language.
That is so fucking crazy.
Oh, man.
Well, it's not super crazy.
But it's like the stupidest term I could have imagined for that question, actually, so it sounds about par for the course for Australian slang.
Oh, yeah.
Well, just answer the question. Do you want to give birth to a baby or no?
I'll think about it.
No, that didn't get me in the mood. It was a beautiful ceremony and everything, but when 100% convinced me, I would hate a wedding. Like, if I was having a wedding, I would hate it.
The attention or the stress?
No, like, I don't know. The attention. Like, having to do, like, the dance in front of your family, the kiss, get married in front of everyone, go through this, like, really regimented plan. I don't know. I feel like I'd be miserable. Absolutely
miserable.
Did you
also... Did you give a speech?
No, just Danny. Danny was the best man, so he gave the speech.
He gave a nice speech.
It was a very nice speech.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. That's awesome. Yeah, I kind of... agree. It seems like it's super stressful. I mean, you could have a small wedding though. You could just have a courthouse wedding or something like that. Doesn't have to be.
Well, yeah, that's definitely an option.
That's the way to do it in my mind. You go to the courthouse, you get married, then you just throw a regular party after.
Yeah, I think so as well. I've always seen like posts on Reddit, and I'm bringing this up as a segue to Reddit because Kyle wants to talk about Reddit, but I've seen posts on Reddit. Some of the most heartbreaking posts are about like brides fucking other dudes at their weddings as well, like cheating on their husband at the weddings with like best men and stuff like that. I've seen a shocking amount of posts like that. And I
wonder how many of those are just fishing for updates, though, because that's like a classic heartbreak story, and how many of those are legitimate.
And I'm wondering where they would find time. Like, where would they find the time to do it? Because during your wedding day, you're nonstop, not only running around, but being watched by other people, like, at all times.
Yeah,
but it does happen. The thing about Reddit is you read so many sad-ass stories in a row that you think some of these have to be just bait or fake.
I'm sure some of them are.
Yeah.
You have to realize the built-in bias of... Some of them, of course, are fake, but I think most of them aren't, because sad people just tend to gravitate to that site because they have specific subreddits for everything. I'm sure there is a subreddit for people who got cheated on their wedding day at exactly 6 p.m. or like 6:13 p.m. or something. I'm sure there's a sub for it. And people go there, and even if it has like 97 members, people talk about it. And Jackson and I have a couple of favorite subreddits that we sometimes just peruse and send each other for the sheer feeling of schadenfreude that it gives us. And which one would you like to start with, Jackson? We have a couple of links here that I noted down. We were sending each other.
You can start with whatever you want.
Oh, that is so... I get first dibs. I'll bring up a new one, I think, that we haven't read before. I actually have this post... bookmarked, because once in a while I like to read this because it's just so funny to me. Have you guys heard of a subreddit called r/sissy?
Nope, but I'm going there now.
So these are guys who watch a lot of sissification, bimbofication, feminization porn, and they like to cross-dress, and they buy like Japanese schoolgirl outfits, and they buy lip gloss, and they basically just want to be bimbos, right? And they really hype themselves up like, yeah, I want to be a bimbo. I want to be tooled and manhandled by big burly men. I want to be their little sissy bitch. So here's a post from 2 years ago. I don't know who the user is because they deleted their account afterwards. I find, it says, I hated sucking my first cock. I finally worked to the courage to meet a guy off of Grindr. I want to suck his cock with no reciprocation. He ended up driving to my apartment and parking on the street, where I got into the passenger seat and began sucking him off. He told me his dick is 6 inches, but it was definitely 4 inches at the most. I could even take him into my throat because he was so small. He was also very overweight and unkempt, which was a huge turnoff for me. While I was sucking him off, he rubbed my asshole, which made me gag because I was imagining how dirty his fingers were, and I didn't want them anywhere near me. After about 3 minutes, he finished in my mouth, and it tasted absolutely awful, nearly making me puke. I gagged, but swallowed his load anyway. I then got out of his car and walked back into my apartment.
Why would you go on for 3 minutes? Why, with all these feelings that you're feeling, why would you continue for 3 minutes? That's a long time for something weird.
Well, at that point, you're committed.
Yeah, maybe the ending is worth it.
That's how I know I want to have sex with a man, when I think I don't want his fingers anywhere near me. Nothing gets me harder.
You know it's bad when you think somebody's fingers are too dirty for your asshole. Like my poor poop.
Ew, my poop. He's going to get it infected. Ugh.
All right, he continues. I then got out of his car and walked back into my apartment when I nearby vomited from the thought of his hygiene. I brushed my teeth and scrubbed myself down viciously in the shower. The whole experience makes me never want to service a man again. I'm so disgusted by him and the experience that I'm getting tested next Tuesday. I genuinely think this may have killed the sissy kink for me.
Dang, what a shame.
The top piece of advice for this one from the comments is, I think you need to be willing to call it off next time if the guy is gross. No shit. Like, immediately. Yeah. If it was that, like, disgusting. That
why would this man start his kink with a hobo? Like, what's your fucking point there?
Well, I imagine he got catfished. I imagine when because he said he showed up and was like overweight and unkempt and shit. So I imagine on Grindr he had better photos right. that misled him.
Oh yeah, and he lied about his dick size.
I could also see it being a mental thing and then turning into a very, very real thing. Like, oh yeah, this dirty random guy, I'll do it. And then you finally get to it and it's like, oh god, this sucks. I don't want to do this anymore.
Oh god, he's touching my arsehole.
Yeah, it turns out complete strangers can be gross. Who knew? Yeah. Somebody who you don't know, and maybe he doesn't shower. You don't know.
Okay, let's assume that he catfished or whatever, but he still shows up and you still see him, this homeless man or whatever. You don't then continue on at that point. You say no, and then you don't regret your first sissy encounter or whatever it is. Like, you just say no.
Yeah, that sounds to be the consensus here is, why didn't you just leave, girl? But this is what happens. I think these guys just hype themselves up so much watching porn, like, yeah, this is gonna be awesome, I want to do this in real life, and then they actually experience it and it's just nothing like they imagined. It's just some fat sweaty guy coming in their mouth and they're like, what?
the common one like that's fucking gross all the time is, have you ever seen like in hentai where it's like, oh, his dick cheese, his fucking smegma? And it's like, that'd be so disgusting in real life, and yet they fetishize it so hard. It's fucking gross.
I can't say I've seen a lot of smegma hentai, as shocking as that's going to be to hear.
I'll have to link my collection.
We've talked about this before. Yeah, it's like a whole subgenre of, I'm a fat incel with smegma, but this lolicon having sex with me, she's so into smegma. All she wants is to lick my smegma. It's like, what the fuck?
There's tons of hentai where the girl, it like gives her thoughts and she's just thinking the whole time, oh, he doesn't wash his dick. It smells. It's stinky and gross and has dick cheese, but I can't stop sucking it. I just can't. Oh, boy.
Do you think it's a thing like where they want the girl to be as disgusting and like porn-brained as
them? Degraded.
It's attractive.
They like the degradation. Yeah. The slutifying them, making them objects. It's regular porn thing too, you know. How many porn have you seen with women where it's just like, I don't know, bondage or stuff where they just like talk to them and call them like a whore and shit? Like, it's pretty common.
I mean, all porn is like objectification of whoever is in it.
Yeah,
generally.
Or when the bull puts his asshole on your wife's face. Do you have that one pulled up?
I don't, but I can find it. Yeah, so another one that we've been enjoying going over just for the fucking, just the hilarity of the pain that the posters are experiencing. Because what's sweet about it is that they do it to themselves. They're so porn brain that they convince themselves mm-hmm. that this kind of stuff is what they want. And then they actually do it and it's immediate regret. And they've got no one else to blame but themselves. So obviously a big one for that is cuckoldry. So we've been browsing r/cuckoldpsychology. And these posts are so fucking disgusting.
Cuckold psychology?
Yeah, there's a whole...
Yeah, we've talked about this stuff before. It is... It's Reddit, of course, so there's like 1,000 different cuckold porn subs, but this one specifically isn't... Like, most of the posts don't have any images or videos. It's not for porn. It's more so people just discussing cuckoldry and their experiences and like, hey, what's your favorite thing to do? And that sort of a sub.
Yeah. Wait, does the fact that we're just reading cuckold psychology posts mean that we're like cuckold cucks because we're just watching them? Maybe we have to get in there and start commenting on them. Well, that's what cuckolds do, that's right? They watch their wives get fucked, but now we're just watching them.
Yeah, that's kind of the same thing as like watching anything else ever. Like, what do you mean?
True, yeah. I just want to make sure that we're not cucks.
No, I think we're safe.
This podcast is brought to you by Mint Mobile.
Yay.
Yeah, real quick, before we dive into that one, we just got to get this one out of the way. This podcast is brought to you by Mint Mobile. So when I heard that for a limited time, all Mint Mobile wireless plans were $15 a month when you purchase a 3-month plan, I thought, what's the catch? But it turns out there isn't one. Mint Mobile's secret sauce is that they sell wireless service online straight to your cellular. You like that alliteration? I do. They cut out the cost of retail mm-hmm. stores and pass the sweet savings directly on to you. I'm once again going to call out one of our four hosts. You might be able to guess via context clues, but there is a certain person on this podcast who very much values his privacy and tends to really, really value it due to extenuating circumstances that could get him into legal and life-threatening trouble, let's say. And with Mint Mobile, he decided that was the right phone plan for him and told us all about how simple it is and how great it is and how it's great mm-hmm. because there is no SIM card. It's all done online. There is a lot of things there to help you as a customer make sure that you're getting the phone data that you need without having to sign up for this giant, over-threatening, looming info doxing network, all sorts of terrible things that come with them. All they give you is a premium wireless plan starting at $15 a month. Use your own phone, bring your phone number, all your contacts. You can ditch overpriced wireless plans with Mint Mobile's limited time deal to get 3 months of premium for a $15 a month service. To get this new customer offer and your new 3-month unlimited wireless plan for just $15 a month, go to mintmobile.com/official. That's mintmobile.com/official. Cut your wireless bill to $15 a month at mintmobile.com/official. $45 upfront payment required, which is equivalent to $15 a month. New customers on first 3-month plan only. Speeds will slow above 40 gigabytes on the unlimited plan. Additional taxes, fees, and restrictions apply. And see Mint Mobile for details, guys. I don't have to read you all this. You can read it yourself. But if you just want to switch to a more streamlined provider, mintmobile.com/official. Yes.
Thank you, Mint Mobile. So back to the cuck stuff. This post... This post is about, it's titled, "My Wife Has Done Dirty Things, But 3 Casual Things Drive Me Crazy." And I'm sorry for the detail that we're about to get into, but I really wanted to just like, I really wanted to show how like actually gross and pathetic these people are.
Yeah, I think everyone needed the education on how pathetic cuckoldry can be.
I mean, it's funny. What do you want? It's funny. It's funny to laugh at.
Well, you don't have to phrase it as some kind of like educational purpose. It's just fun to laugh at.
It's a PSA.
Yeah. I've seen my wife do it all, but 3 casual things stand out in my head. Number 1, before she even ever rimmed him, He was on top of her, squatting in her face, fucking her throat. Then he sat on her face and she tongued his asshole to my surprise. Later, I asked how she knew his asshole was clean enough to lick it. She tells me that when he fucks her throat, his asshole smooshes down on her nose and she smells his asshole to determine if it smells clean enough to lick. That blew my fucking mind. Why is he so amazed? Like, what? Blew his mind.
It's like an anime villain. His impossible. His asshole is cleaner than mine.
It's like Death Note.
Yeah. I can't smell anything in his butthole. But that's where poop comes from. Incomprehensible.
Just talking about your wife smelling another dude's asshole to confirm if it's clean or not.
Well, that's a bro thing. You do that in the shower.
But in this post, there's a whole paragraph preamble of how his wife has been used up by a bunch of different men too, and he's so eager. The way he describes it is just him jerking off as he's writing this. And I should also mention, he writes that preamble paragraph intro about what a whore his wife is. And then all of these items that Jackson is going to read, they are in like twice the font size. He used the header format.
So these are really important.
Yeah, these are the important parts.
It's like an eye exam.
I always wonder what the cuckolds are like outside of the whole fantasy and the sexual element of it. Like if this guy's a professional dentist or something like that, or like you wouldn't ever be able to tell that he's a cuckold behind the scenes. I would like to know the background on him. Number two, another time he does his thing and squats on her face and shoved his cock down her throat. He's about to stick his asshole on her lips when she stops him for a second, spreads his ass cheeks and starts to examine this guy's butthole. He's now squatting on her face with his butthole an inch from her eye. She's spreading his cheeks and she's examining a discoloration in his skin right next to his butthole. My wife is a nurse, mind you. Shouldn't she be worried about like pink eye then? She's literally an inch away from this dude's butthole and she's looking at it and
that
she
just
tells
makes it
him
hotter.
We need to keep an eye on it, literally. Then she says, okay, and pulls his asshole down on her face, and she continues to stick her tongue up his asshole, and he goes back and forth from throat fucking to getting his butthole licked. The whole post is just, like, very focused on butthole licking.
Do you think she pulled out a little monocle and just went, hold on.
Oh, like the thing that, like, jewelers used to examine diamonds.
Yeah, a little magnifying glass. Just went, oh, yeah, interesting. She pulled out a little notepad, wrote it down, took notes.
I think our assholes are our biggest weakness because we never check them, so there could be like some kind of discoloration down there that we don't know about that could be concerning.
True.
I guess that's true, but I also don't want to have a medical exam while I'm throat-fucking someone. Like, not the time or place. You're bumming me out right now. I don't want to know I have ass cancer. Can you tell me after?
Nothing gets me harder than having my asshole surgically inspected by a medical professional.
I don't ever want my asshole looked at. I want that to be like just empty space for all of existence. Just no one ever looked at it. And then finally, of course, he made my wife admit that she loves big dicks and that bigger is better. That was the end of that.
That was a tame ending for what was an otherwise chaotic experience.
Yeah, how is that so? Three casual things drive me crazy. Just that she admits that she loves big dicks. Lame. You can come up with something better than that. That's why I don't think that this is like fan fiction. If it was like entirely fan fiction, he could have come up with something way wilder in the third spot for that, right?
I mean, it doesn't have to be fan fiction. These people absolutely exist. Nobody has to make this stuff up.
Yeah, for sure. It's just
the regret ones.
So it was not a regret one. Like, he was super happy with his experience.
Oh, no. Yeah, he's super happy. Absolutely. It's also just, like, actually so gross.
I'm trying to find the one with the crying. Oh, here we go.
There's a lot with crying.
I know. This is from Throw R, a Gearhead, in Relationship Advice, a random sub, actually. Me, 32M, and my wife, 28F, tried cuckoldry, and I cried. Burner account because I'm embarrassed. Me and my wife, Anne, for anonymity, have been together for 5 years, been married for 3 now. I love Anne a ton, and we've been having hardly any problems with one another. Blah, blah, blah. We haven't been... had sex as passionately as before. By the way, whenever their English is always so fucking broken that I struggle to read it. I don't know if they're always just on substances or if they're just that dumb, but this man is bored with his sex life. I guess I voiced my concerns to her about us drifting apart, and she agreed that we haven't been as lovey-dovey as we both would like. She mentioned she was getting bored by the routine sex. During that conversation, we talked about spicing up the bedroom. Uh-oh. My friend texted me a week's prior that he tried this kink called cuckoldry with his girlfriend.
They're recruiting.
Do guys just casually drop this to their buddies, by the way?
No way.
I had my wife fucked. You should try too. And that he's been loving it. After hearing how much it turned him on, I was definitely curious. I looked up videos of it and everything, and I kind of liked it. And then I told Anne about it. She looked physically repulsed. So much so that I felt an immediate wave of regret. So immediately, I followed it up with other stuff we could try out, like bondage and whatnot. I figured since she knew more about kink than me and has been more active in the scene, she'd appreciate me offering more diverse stuff. Where does it get to the crying part? At first, she went crazy on me, saying that I was an asshole for even thinking about there being a third person in play, but I really don't get it. It's just a kink, and she can still love me just as much without having feelings for the other guy, question mark. I still love her, but I want to experiment. I feel stuck, exclamation mark.
Wait, if they haven't even tried, like, bondage and stuff yet, you're going, like, jumping straight in the deep end.
Yeah, this seems like an escalation. Yeah, try peeing on each other or something.
Well, it's just he got such a glowing review from his friend. Yeah, he's just like, all right, run it, I guess.
You've never gone to a restaurant just based on the Yelp reviews? Like, that's what he's doing here, you know?
Well, she did agree to it after I begged her to forget about it. She told me that she can't and that she'd rather make me happy under the pretense that she would not do it again. So we started looking for a third on apps like Tinder and Bumble, and we eventually found a nice-looking man in his 40s, whom I will call Alex. We went on a quote-unquote date with him to discuss everything. So a week later, he came to our apartment and they did it. At first, I was not too sure and wanted to stop them. Suddenly, again, I started tearing up and asked to take a quick bathroom break. But I was red in the face and there were tears stuck in my beard. I couldn't...
Tears stuck in my beard, huh?
Yeah. I couldn't stop crying when I thought about how she might enjoy it more with him than me.
Why does revelation only happen when they're getting when they're like in the process of it, when she's getting fucked? It's like suddenly they realize
how? He was just too deep in the Coomer zone and he just wasn't thinking.
That's the moment that fantasy and reality collide, and a lot of these people realize that the reality of this is terrible and not fun and awkward.
Yeah. Not just collide, but like you have to remember how recent of a thing like internet porn is, and it collided with millions of years of lizard brain evolution that says, wait, another man is fucking my mate. Wait, stop. Red alert. Stop it.
But then why is it an attractive fetish in the first place then? If we have that like kind of biological...
It's gotta be humiliation.
I've never understood it.
It can be an offshoot of a lot of things. Humiliation. Or the whole porn viewing aspect. Like, you want to watch your woman get rightfully fucked, or there's probably a bunch. I was scrolling through this subreddit that you guys were browsing, and some post said, who became a cuckold because they were cheated on? And that could be part of it, where you just kind of...
That is a big thing, too. Yeah,
fixate on that incident and then turn it into a fetish. I bet there's a lot of angles to get here, but, you know, a lot of guys don't realize that they don't want it.
Right. I just Googled it like an absolute geriatric here. I said, why do people like cuckolding? And the number one thing was from the Chicago Tribune in 2017. The reason this is enjoyable is because it's humiliating. Cuckoldry takes our deep shames and insecurities and eroticizes them. Watching a partner with someone else being present and orchestrating that humiliation themselves is a way to take back power in a situation where they might otherwise feel powerless. But you know what else would be good to taking back that power is not being in that situation where you're powerless in the first place.
Yeah.
Like you're solving a problem you're creating.
I never understood that language anyway. People always say that about self-destructive things. Like fat activists will say, me eating 5 cakes is a way of taking back power. It's like, me getting punched in the mouth is my way of beating and winning this fight. That's not how it works. You're just destroying yourself.
Yeah.
Anyway, he continues.
We see that in posts like this. Like, it actually, like, just leads to so many further issues.
tears and like, beards.
Destroys, just destroys relationships, yeah.
After a long talk with them, we came to the conclusion that this fetish thing isn't for me. By the way, his wife and the guy are now in the afterglow. He's just smoking in bed and like chilling. Just chilling and hugging. And he's on the side still crying, wiping the tears from his beard and probably applying like lotion and oils to it. So he's like, I don't know if this is for me. I suggest that we try it again in the future. And Seafall enjoyed more this time. Now my wife is upset at me for even politely asking. This was a week ago and she still hasn't been touching me or hugging or kissing me or anything. I think she's really upset. I don't think I did anything wrong. I wanted to try something new. And now I'm embarrassed because I did this all in front of her and another man. What possibilities are open for me now that she's upset, and how can I make it up to her?
Another angle that we haven't even talked about that goes along with this stuff is how many stories have we read where the woman runs away with the bull? And just ends up starting a new relationship with him and dumping the husband.
Those ones are always funny. The ones where like, yeah, the bull, not the bull, the woman, like just goes along with it to make her husband happy or whatever. Yep. Like she clearly doesn't really care for it or whatever in the beginning, but then she goes through with it and she ends up loving it and the boyfriend hates it. And then she has to pretend like she didn't love it and enjoy herself while he's like crying into his beard or whatever. Those ones are always like so frequent.
It's like a very recurring thing. When a woman is with a stronger, better man, she starts mapping her love onto him as well, and you can't really separate sex and love. It's a mystery. It just keeps happening. Nobody knows why. Science cannot explain. That's so weird.
Oh, man, I feel like for the woman, you have to just inherently lose a fair amount of respect for your partner if they're willing to like watch you get fucked by another person.
Absolutely.
Which is funny because so many of these posts are like, oh, the only reason this happened is because we trust each other so much and we love each other so much. And it... I don't know, man. I don't know.
And it's the follow-up is always the same as, you guys, has anyone else noticed that their wife isn't looking at them the same anymore? Yeah. What did you think was going to happen, you dummy? She doesn't think of you as a fucking man anymore. You cannot, like...
You've devalued yourself.
Your wife watches you lick some other guy's cum out of her butthole. It's like, that's it. You're no longer a man in her eyes. Wasn't that the whole kink?
There's another thing I noticed about the cuckold stuff. A big recurring theme is like they always push each other to like clean up the guy's mess. Like the cuck will clean up the guy's mess. I thought it was like more of the cuck just watches from like the closet or whatever. He doesn't actually like partake in any of the events. But no
he's the puppet master in a lot of these. Yeah,
yeah, he comes in and cleans up the cum, which is gross.
No, it is a big part. So if you go to the Cuckold Psychology subreddit and you know how on Reddit you can order by the top posts given a time span. Mm-hmm. If you order top posts of the past month, like 5 out of the top 10 are some variation of the cuck wanting to eat the cum. Is kissing the wife after she's taken a load in the mouth? ? Wife wants me to suck bull's cock. Cleanup duty. The psychological effect of your bull's cream pie. And it goes on and on. Like, this is a common theme of them just wanting...
It's like a research paper.
The psychological effect of the bull's cum is such an incredible topic to explore.
Who's got the master's thesis on that one?
The full research dissertation.
I think this is written from the bull's perspective. Maybe you started off with condoms only. The sex is still exciting and your wife can still enjoy herself with no worries. Maybe the bull pulls out. But when a woman begs her lover to come inside her while moaning, maybe in between... this is just fanfic.
Okay, wait. Here's a question for you guys. We all know that none of us would ever be cucked. Like, I think that's fairly safe to say. I don't think any of us are for that. Would you guys ever bull, though? Would you ever fuck another dude's wife if he asked?
For sure. Yeah, absolutely.
I think that would be the most... That would probably be the most single, most uncomfortable conversation for your friend to come up to you. Be like, hey, you want a bull?
No, it doesn't... No.
Yeah, I wouldn't do it for a friend. Yeah, absolutely not. Yeah.
But like, if they look at me and pinky promise that, you know, it's all good, I can do it, and he's not going to shoot me with a gun, then yeah, I'm in. Let's do it.
Yeah, I'll do like a background psychological evaluation.
Yeah.
Even if you were down for it, Andrew, how do you know the guy isn't going to be crying next to the bed with tears stuck in his beard, and he's going to be aggressive afterwards and pull out his gun and shoot you? No matter how much he promises it.
I've got good headphones and strong legs, so I'm good. We'll take that as it comes, you know? We'll just figure that one out.
Also, that's the other part. Like, are you okay with the cuck coming up and giving you a blowjob?
Yeah,
clearly. Or do you really want to watch a guy lick the cum? Lick your cum?
Yeah, he can eat my cum. Finish on his wife's tummy and be like, all right, dessert's here, brother. I'm going to go home.
Well, me and your wife, Tanette, are going to be having sushi, and you'll be having my cum. Isn't that lovely?
Yeah. I'll put a cloche on it or something.
You seriously don't mind another dude eating your cum? I would still have a problem with that.
I think it's fine. I wouldn't mind it. No.
Yeah, he's eating it off the plate and we'll let it ride. I don't care.
Yeah. I'd play like an Uno reverse card and I'd fuck the husband in front of the wife. Be like, aha! You didn't see this coming, did you?
Gotcha.
Yeah.
Yeah, but okay, how would you feel though if it was one of these situations where you fuck the wife good, she has the time of her life, it's like actually just the best sex of her life, you can see it in her eyes, and then you cause their relationship to implode, and you're like the impetus of it.
I did both of them a favor. They shouldn't have been together in the first place.
That's not my fight. That's not my fault. If I was the catalyst, then there was already problems there, you know? No one decides to do this without something in their relationship spurring it on.
You wouldn't feel a little bit bad?
No.
I don't know, not at all. I wouldn't feel bad at all. Like, this is...
You'd feel great.
It was going to happen one way or the other, honestly, at that point.
If not me, then someone else.
Yeah, might as well be me.
Yeah, I call dibs.
I mean, that really is kind of just on him.
Yeah, well, it's absolutely on him, but I don't know. I just feel like if I was in that situation personally and I had a hand in it, as in like my dick was the key that unlocked Hell's Gate or whatever, like Pandora's box, then I would feel like just a little bit bad for even being in the situation, I guess.
Is your penis the key?
It's like Kingdom Hearts.
Again,
Yeah.
Should have gone to church instead of gooning to cuckold porn that much. That's on him. And I also wouldn't afterwards date the woman either because she's a cheater.
Well, like
they're both
cheater.
Just for the street.
She's not necessarily a cheater. They're like, it's still bad. Yeah. Anyway, I think being a bull sounds great though. A very powerful position to be in.
Yeah, I mean, the stories you could tell would be unbelievable.
Yep.
Yeah, so I fucked this dude's wife and he started crying.
And then while he's crying, he licked the cum off. And it's like, okay, dude.
I said, cheer up, buttercup, and I served him my cum.
Yeah, and left on a silver platter. And then I had to go to the ball game, so I dipped out.
It's great. Okay, wait. Okay, here's another one, though. If your friend told you, if your friend messaged you saying, hey, just had the best experience of my life, watch my girl get fucked, would you immediately, like, lose respect for them and stop being their friend?
I wouldn't stop being their friend, but I would 100% change my impression of them.
Yep.
Yeah.
Dude's trying to sell me on watching his girl get fucked and how much he liked it. I'd be like, brother, I mean, I'm super happy for you, but I don't look at you the same.
Depending on who it was, I'd probably say, well, do I get a turn? Like, are you looking for a bowl? Like, you want to
eat some cum? You said you wouldn't fuck a friend.
Now it depends. Now it changes everything.
if he's bragging about it, I mean, I'm good friends with him. Maybe I just got to be a good friend again. You know, give him what he wants.
Yeah, but you're just never going to look at them the same.
True.
Hollywood idea where... Like, oh, just compartmentalize everything. It's just sex. It's not the same thing. You don't have to look at me different. It's just what we do in the bedroom. It's like, okay, yeah, but like I saw you lick my cum off her feet. I can't just shove that in a corner of my mind and still go to the movies with you the same as always.
That perspective's already broken the instant it comes up. Whether or not I indulge in it and like fuck the dude's wife As soon as one of my friends comes up to me and goes, yeah, I watch my wife just get fucked and I love it. Like, it immediately it makes me think, okay, cool, man. I can never look at you the same way.
Yeah. It's like finding out they're into any, like, super extreme, I guess, fetish or whatever, if they were to tell you that. If it's, like, nothing you could just, like, forget about. But with cucking, yeah, it's just so different.
There's definitely levels. Like, if a buddy, on the same token, if the same friend is like, I love eating shit, like, I have a huge scat fetish, yeah. I, again, would look at them a little different. Like, he's not hurting me by eating poop, but it's like, come on, man, you're my friend, please don't. Good. I don't like to hear that.
If they are happy and consenting and everything's worked out with it, like, and everything's fine, good for them. They're living their best life, but I don't know if I want to participate in that. I don't know if I want to be a person in that.
Well, he's not asking you to participate in it. He's just, like, really excited to tell you, I guess.
Sure. Okay, yeah. I guess it'd just be something in the back of your mind. You know, like, hey, this guy gets his wife fucked. Anyway, let's run another game of Smash, I guess. Okay.
Yeah, and, but in your head, you look at him like Reek. Like, here's Reek coming.
It'd be a stain on the friendship for sure. And whether or not I want to pretend I'm super duper tolerant and, you know, just accepting of these things, which I would be, there would still be that thing in the back of my mind that's like, okay, well, yeah, that happened. You told me that.
You'd be like, well, this just fundamentally changes my perception of you. Yeah. You're not who I thought you were.
You know, you used to be my friend who I bonded over, like, video games with, but now you're my friend who lets guys fuck his wife, and that's just how it's gonna be now, I guess.
I think when it gets to that point,
it's such a powerful thing that that's always going to be the label of that person from then on, no matter what they do, no matter what things they're into or anything. It's always going to be the guy who lets his wife get fucked by other dudes.
It's like if your friend became the president of the United States. It's like you could have all these things growing up and all these memories, but once that happens, that's all there is. Yeah. That's it. It is just so
large and overwhelming. Same with the shit thing. If it was a friend that ate shit or whatever. I was trying to rack my head just then, thinking about, like, which one I would prefer, and I absolutely would prefer the friend who just lets his wife get fucked than the guy that eats shit.
I agree, because at least that's hygienic and quote-unquote safe, whereas eating shit can just kill you. It is really not good.
I mean, we just read a post about a man squatting on his wife's eyeballs. I don't know how safe that is. I don't know if he's a flatulent during...
It's so fucking true.
I'm sure there's some scat play. I'm sure there's a Venn diagram overlap.
We feed our bull Chipotle before we have fun, just to really spice things up.
I mix laxatives in his food.
This is fucking disgusting.
The grossest episode of the show ever.
Yucky. Ew, poopy.
Okay, go ahead, Jackson. We cut you off there.
I didn't say anything. I just said I
have another subreddit.
Weren't you?
Oh, no, I think I was done. I think we'd just be regurgitating the same stuff at this point.
Okay.
So, what else is going on, you guys? Anything new?
Well, apparently, I don't know if you guys care about this, but I like cocoa a lot, and apparently cocoa is now becoming a rare metal. At least it has surpassed copper in price, because there is a cocoa crisis now going on in Africa, because local miners are apparently invading the farms, the cocoa farms, and destroying the soil with their chemicals, mining for gold, and then leaving. So cocoa prices are now skyrocketing somehow. And I'm a little worried because I like chocolate.
Wasn't there a cocoa crisis like 10 years ago where they were saying, hey, we're going to run out of cocoa. It's going to be a problem. It's going to happen. Is this just where we live?
Well, that is still going to happen. It just hasn't happened yet.
Okay. So is this a different thing then? Or is this part of it?
Same, I would assume. I don't know.
What are we talking about? Cocoa? Like the stuff in chocolate?
Yeah,
cocoa.
Like pre-chocolate.
Yes.
What do you mean it's going to run out? Isn't it something that can be regrown?
Well, it's still a very hard process. It's like avocados, where it's like so expensive and so time-consuming to make avocados and like harvest avocados.
Mm-hmm. And the demand for cocoa is far, far greater than the supply replenishment. Like the entire world wants chocolate, you know.
Okay, the terminology is not run out then. It like you can always get more of it, but it's not going to be financially feasible to keep doing it.
Yeah, I thought you meant it was like coal or something. We had a finite amount.
Would you buy a Hershey bar, or I guess in Australia, a Hunkley Dunkley bar, whatever you guys call it, if it costs $9? You know, for you, it probably doesn't matter, but for a lot of people, that's way too expensive for just a bar of chocolate.
No, it might become a luxury. So you mentioned 10 years ago, Andrew. So I pulled this graph from all the way from 2005, and the price is currently the highest it's ever been.
Fuck.
By an increase of 500%.
Oh, fuck. It's over.
The new Mad Max is just going to have Immortan Joe open the, like, pipes to chocolate, I guess. Yeah,
it's going to gush chocolate like Willy Wonka. Oh, I'd pay to see that.
That I would watch, actually.
Damn, dude. Yeah, these graphs are crazy. I highly recommend whoever's listening to this check out the cocoa price graph, because that shit is a... like Mount Everest at the most recent years with how it's going up. That's nuts.
Yeah, I never would have thought, oh shit, I should have invested in cocoa, of all things, that could have like quadrupled your money. And apparently there's also a disease in the leaves. Where can you not just fucking grow cocoa anywhere?
That's what I'm saying. Greenhouse? That's what I'm saying. Yeah, I'm sure it can be grown. It's like equatorial, right? Because it's like... in the middle of Africa,
like
that's
hot
where they're
and humid.
Yeah, so maybe Australia would be a good place to grow
hot temperatures. Cocoa. So Australia would not work because it also requires high humidity and constant rainfall. So desert climates would not work either. You basically kind of just have to have a subtropic climate, and that's it. It's kind of the only place it grows. Apparently,
we do have subtropic climate.
You do? I thought you were mostly desert.
Far north Queensland. No. Far north Queensland. We have some of the oldest tropical forests in the world, like the Daintree Forest. Very old forest. And we got a lot of like rainfall up there.
I very often forget, and I apologize to you and all of Australia, that Australia's just massive. Like a ridiculously enormous, large country.
And yeah, you're correct that most of Australia is arid desert. But our east coast, which is where everyone in Australia lives essentially, is nice and green because of the rainfall coming from the Pacific Ocean. So we're pretty, that's why we all live over here on this side.
Yeah.
It's nice.
If you want a real eye-opener, open a population density map of Australia and notice that 95% of the country is empty.
So what you're telling
me is
yeah,
Jackson is in the perfect position to become a cocoa warlord.
Actually, I did read a report that the government is like offering grants to people to grow or something. They're like incentivizing cocoa growing over here. So maybe
do it.
The next big step. Yeah.
Start the cocoa cartel. Should.
Yeah, you need a hobby anyway. Do it.
So to let my wife get fucked.
Your constant browsing of cuckold subreddits. I think you need a real hobby. Grow some chocolate.
Oh, no. I was going a different direction. I meant because like his other hobbies have imploded, like Legos and all that shit. So I was like,
imploded?
Okay,
what do you mean? I just got bored of them.
No, that's not true.
It's not like I stepped on a Lego brick and broke my leg or anything. It didn't implode. I just got bored.
Yeah, something much worse happened. I made you build the Taj Mahal with me. And now you hate Legos.
You imploded it for me.
Yeah, and now I feel bad. So start growing chocolate.
Oh no, is he gonna ruin chocolate? I don't know if I want Jackson touching cocoa with all of his bad juju. Actually,
yeah,
you kind of like you have dark clouds following you. I don't know.
Yeah, everything I like gets ruined. So
chocolate just gets poisoned for some reason.
We had Lego, we had Star Wars. Yeah, it all went downhill.
I don't know how you would ruin chocolate though.
You can't.
I mean, you make bad chocolate. That happens all the time. There's so many dog shit chocolates out there.
Mm-hmm.
Like what?
That's true. But like if you keep it just simple, just regular milk chocolate, dark chocolate, white chocolate.
Yeah, I mean, you can always make super simple stuff like that.
But even like Hershey's is that, and that sucks. Hershey's sucks.
Oh my God, you couldn't be more wrong. I love Hershey's. You know what I hate though is chocolate chips. I think chocolate chips is the lowest quality chocolate in the world.
What is that? Like, just a little drop?
They're not very good. Yeah, the drops, you can buy them in bags for cookies.
They're accurately described as chips of chocolate, Jackson. You might have seen them.
chips for us are like potato.
Well, they're not supposed to eat those on their own, though, to be fair. Like, chocolate chips are, they're supposed to blend into like ice cream and cookies and stuff. So they're not supposed to taste.
Typically they're made for utilization, like baking in or mixing into stuff. But occasionally you get things where they put them on top. And I agree with Charlie. Chocolate chips just raw on top of things sucks. I hate it too. I agree.
Yep. Bunch of goddamn trash. So if you start making chocolate chips, Jackson, that's a good way of immediately killing chocolate for Kaya and everyone else with any kind of level of taste buds.
I'm not going to make chocolate chips. It's all good. I don't see a market for
it. My taste buds, I have like, I don't know. I like dark chocolate, like 99% cacao chocolate stuff. And most people hate that word. Yeah, they just tell me, this just tastes like dirt, Kaya.
I actually don't care that much for chocolate in general, so I mean, I'll eat it. I like it, but it's never my go-to.
I love chocolate.
Same. I didn't think you liked chocolate. I don't think I've ever seen you eat chocolate, Charlie.
Me? Oh, if I'm ever eating a dessert, it's always chocolate. Anything chocolate.
This guy also sneaks it. We went to a party, or maybe it was at the warehouse. I think it was at the warehouse. And there was just a bowl of Reese's, and just all throughout the night, this man just grabs one and eats it and then moves on with his day.
That definitely wasn't me. That wasn't you? I don't really like Reese's that much. No, Matt loves Reese's. I'm the Oreo guy.
Was it Oreos? Because there was a bowl of candy somewhere, and you saw it, and you were like, oh, no. Oh, there it is. And then like you just were like, okay, I'll have one. And then you kept doing that over and over again.
Yeah, there was little packs of Oreos and Hershey's bars. It wasn't Reese's.
It wasn't Reese's. It was, But I do remember that happening with you, where, like, you saw the candy bowl and just went, ah, shit, now I gotta start eating it.
The demon comes out.
That's probably my most controversial chocolate opinion. I used to love Oreos, but now I just find them pretty overrated and mid.
That is diabolical to hear. Oh, my God.
No, they're so boring.
What is wrong with you guys?
It's just kind of mid.
I don't know. Yeah,
I think they're a good sometimes treat. Like, I'm not always in the mood for Oreos, but every now and then I'm just like really fucking hankering for one. Like, oh God, I need it so bad. I need a goddamn Oreo.
I actually think Oreos is just like the perfect junk food. And it's also the most versatile. Like, fucking Oreo cheesecake is the best flavor of cheesecake. Oreo milkshakes always go hard. Like, what? It's so good.
It's not the best flavor of cheesecake. I'll fight you on that one. There's much better ones.
What the fuck is the best flavor? Like, what?
Probably a nice plain cheesecake with something drizzled on top, I would say, can't be.
Oh,
deep.
Jesus.
Yeah.
Goodness gracious, this fucking guy.
You get that really, really high quality regular cheesecake and then maybe drizzle some like raspberry or strawberry syrup on top. I'm like, oh, that's the good shit. That's the real stuff.
Do you guys even eat desserts at like restaurants and whatnot?
Yeah, of course.
Well,
if I have room.
Special occasions, like if I'm hanging out with friends or we're at a nice restaurant, but typically I actually don't eat sweets that often, to be honest.
Neither do I.
Yeah, me neither. I do not know the last time I got dessert at a restaurant.
Something that has been fucking me up, though, real bad, that's related, is Quest, the diet and health food company. They make Reese cups. They are exactly the same as Reese cups, but they're like protein and sugar alcohols and all that shit. I can't stop eating those. They taste amazing and they're way, way better for you than a regular Reese cup. And I have one like with every fucking meal now. Oh, they're so good. No, they're not as sweet.
Yeah, there's nothing wrong with that. Those are actually, from what I understand, pretty good for you. Like, they don't use anything nefarious.
They're awesome. They're not as sweet, like not as sugary as a regular Reese cup or chocolate or whatever. And they just feel hearty. Like, I don't feel like I'm having dessert when I eat them. I feel like I'm just topping my meal off with, like, a hearty, I don't know, another piece of the puzzle. Like a peanut butter sandwich, kind of.
It's also a good way of getting a quick hit of protein. They're, like, those are probably, like, 10 grams, I would imagine, per cup or something, because the Quest loads that shit up.
Yeah, I highly, highly, highly recommend them. They're sold out at grocery stores all the time when I look for them, so I get them online. But they're good. I think they're just called Quest cups. And oh fuck, I can't stop eating them. They're just too good.
Andrew's getting too jacked now from all the protein.
I'm gonna gain so much weight. Oh, burn it off by cooking someone. The ultimate plan.
I don't know what my favorite chocolate is. I've kind of like gone off chocolate or just bored by chocolate in general, I think.
So what do you, what's your go-to dessert then, Jackson? What do you like?
Dessert?
Yeah.
I really like creme brulee.
That's a good choice.
Oh my god, this bougie motherfucker. It's a
good choice. I can't fault him. That shit's delicious.
Just burnt caramel. It's delicious. It's not like I have it a lot. Just once a week, maybe.
Okay, that's a lot. Hang on.
Okay, Jesus Christ.
The fuck?
My live-in chef makes it for me for Sunday. No.
Every time the bowl comes over, you guys celebrate with a little creme brulee.
I sit there in my armchair as I watch my wife get fucked with my creme brulee in hand.
You've got it in hand. He goes, wait. And he comes on it. And you go, oh, thank you.
Ew.
Then he does that little like fire trick with it where he lights it on fire like a banana Foster and serves
you.
He prepares at bedside while he fucks your wife.
Yeah, caramelizes the cum.
Master Wayne, can I offer you some more creme brulee?
That's disgusting. I love it.
That is actually disgusting.
You can't ruin creme brulee for me.
Well, good. Grow up and get a real dessert like a piece of chocolate cake.
He calls it creme brulee, and you slurp it down all the same.
Creme brulee?
Yeah, creme brulee.
Yeah, fucking creme brulee is a great dessert. What's your problem with creme brulee? It's easy, it's light.
It's fine, I don't know.
I love it. I think it's great, and I think you're right.
So your favorite dessert is just a fucking piece of chocolate cake?
Well, there's so much you can do with a piece of chocolate cake.
You can eat it. It's the same fucking thing every single time.
You can fuck it. You can play games with it. You don't have to eat it, Jackson.
Well, I meant like ways of preparing it. But yeah, you can also fuck it too, I guess.
I like cake. I definitely like chocolate cake. But it's just like I've had a million of them.
Mm.
Well, it sounds like you've had a million creme brulees a month too.
No, it's just the first thing that jumped to my head that is like yum and kind of rare for me. So... that's what I like the most at the moment.
Mm.
I don't know.
Cake is so
what about
boring.
You, Andrew?
I'm a cake hater. Even with that photo again.
My favorite is also a very versatile dessert. I don't think there's anything better on earth than a quality soft serve. Like all the flavors, all the toppings. My favorite thing in the world to do as like a little treat is go to like make your own Froger places. And I just get something completely different every time, and it's always worth it. I fucking love frozen yogurt and soft serve ice cream and that shit like Dole Whip where they do it out of like fruit. Like, oh god, I can never get enough.
I got myself an ice cream machine, actually.
Really?
This past week. I was
like a real one?
Almost never use YouTube anymore, but I couldn't sleep one night and I put on like How It's Made Candy documentary type thing. And I was getting ads because I was just watching it on like in my browser on my phone.
Mm-hmm.
And one of the ads was for, it's called the Ninja Creamy Plus or something like that.
Is that the name of the bowl?
And of course, gross, don't ruin it. But I saw it and I was like, wait, an ad that is actually kind of appropriate. This looks good because my wife loves like the ice cream stuffs and makes herself really thick shakes every day. Mm-hmm. So I figured, okay, I'm not going to click this ad because I don't want to reward them for ads. So I just typed it into Google instead myself and I ordered it. And it's really great. It has all these fucking functions. And I actually get to know what's in the ice cream when I make it now. So, of course, I made myself a coffee ice cream, which is awesome. And it makes slushies, too. Yeah, highly recommend it.
Yeah, this thing actually looks kick-ass. I'm checking it out. I might consider this. But this is dangerous for me. I would power this down, like, twice a day. Fuck.
Oh, I know. It is.
Do you guys...
Again, though, it's nice because you can, like, you get to decide how healthy or bad you want it to be for yourself. So, like, if it says, okay, one cup of sugar in it, you don't have to put a cup of sugar in it, right?
No, you do. Yeah. The recipe said so. What are you doing?
How dare you modify your food?
No, gross. You follow the rules. Or you find a recipe that says two sugar. Then,
fuck,
then
this
you can
looks
do
awesome.
That.
You can even, what the fuck? You can even set it to be scoopable or drinkable? This thing's amazing.
Oh, it makes
that's
slushies, it makes
fire
ice
feature.
Creams, it makes, what are the, I don't even know what the difference between sorbet and ice cream and what's the other one?
Oh, sorbet, gelato? Sorbet is, yeah, gelato. Wait, I don't know the difference between sorbet and gelato.
Fuck, that's cool.
Wait, gelato, isn't gelato like creamy and sorbet is like sweet, maybe.
I have no clue. I stick to the slushy function usually.
If you want to go healthy and do the same thing, there's a product called a Yo Nanas. And it's like the best way I can describe it is it turns fruit into poop, like frozen poop. You put like bananas and frozen fruit in the top. So it's the best way I can describe it. You put frozen fruit in the top and it turns it into like frozen yogurt consistency. And it's really good and it's yummy, but it just looks like it's shitting it out into a bowl. But that's a way to do it healthy if you want.
I just love frozen stuff.
Sounds cool.
Yeah.
Okay, Andrew's now the friend that likes watching his machines shit out ice cream for him.
I forgot to mention I'm naked when I use it. It's just part of the experience, you know?
And you set up the machine on top of your wife's face.
Yep. Mouth open. Mm. I put in a chocolate bar for added realism.
Ew. Some food coloring. Make it brown.
I watch my bull make the ice cream. He makes it better than I do.
I feel like if anyone's going to agree with me on this one, it's going to be Charlie. Charlie, acai bowls are great. Yes or no?
Oh, God, I love acai bowls. Yes. Oh, my Lord. I'm such an acai bowl fiend.
Yeah, they're so good.
I'm with you.
It's kind of like a dessert.
It is kind of like a dessert. Have you had spirulina yet, Jackson?
Never. I don't know what that is. No.
That's like the blue version of an acai bowl. It's really good too.
It's better. I'm gonna put that flag in the ground. Spirulina is better than acai. It's better tasting. It's just better.
That's tough for me to agree with, but spirulina is very, very good.
Mm-hmm.
What is? Okay. So wait, is it like the exact? Wait, it's a type of algae.
You're goddamn right. It is
algae. Yeah.
Algae.
It's delicious shit.
Healthy stuff can taste so good. I still don't know why people hate fruit so much. Or veggies.
Because they're stupid and they don't know how to cook them.
Yeah.
Well, you don't need to cook fruit.
How many people do you know that like hate broccoli and vegetables? And it's because they think that they think the way that you're supposed to fucking cook broccoli. They think that what you do is you either A, just serve it raw with like ranch, which is the worst way to do it, or B, you put it in the microwave and you steam it and then just eat it straight up. It's like these people haven't heard of seasoning. It's crazy.
But I'm not just talking about fat people like the TLC, the Slayton sisters. Every episode is them like taking a frozen bag of broccoli, tossing it in the microwave, and then they just dump it in a plate all plain. They're like, oh, this is disgusting. How do people eat this?
It's because you made it disgusting.
I think I'm going to die. It's like, well, they don't even know how to fucking eat something without ranch on it. And when you take their ranch away, they're lost like little babies.
I know.
Like, what do I do now?
I fucking love broccoli.
People don't know how to cook.
Broccoli's so good.
They just assume that shit tastes bad because they don't know how to make it taste good. When I cook, I make roasted vegetables with every goddamn meal I cook, and I love eating them. They are just actually delicious. Roasted broccoli is one of my favorite things to make. It's so fucking good. Yeah. And people just don't get
broccoli,
that.
Roasted broccoli, caramelized onions, and caramelized carrots.
Love carrots. Caramelizing onions is like the easiest fucking thing on the planet, and yet it's such an easy way to add incredible flavor. It takes nothing to do.
What about duck greased roasted potatoes?
Yes. There's a million and one ways to cook veggies and make them good, and you don't have to load them with butter or do the I'll give you one that actually pisses me off. So I love sweet potatoes. They're one of the best goddamn veggies on the planet ever. I eat them all the time. They're tasty. You can make them a million different ways and they work. But have you ever noticed that every recipe for sweet potatoes is like, oh, load it up with cinnamon and butter and sugar for a tasty treat? It's like, no, you don't have to fucking do that. They're a tasty vegetable on their own. You don't have to make them a dessert, make them unhealthy. You can just roast them up with seasoning. Sweet. They try to make them like a dessert, like a treat, when they're so much better as just part of the meal. It's nuts. Like, how many times have you guys gone to a restaurant and they have sweet potatoes and it comes with marshmallows on top? Have you ever noticed that?
What?
Or like a marshmallow topping or something.
Ew.
I've never seen
what?
That.
Sweet never? Potato marshmallow.
At a barbecue restaurant or like a buffet, they always put a layer of marshmallows on top of the sweet potatoes.
Oh, wow.
I'm not crazy. Happens all the time.
I mean, probably.
That is
Americans
so extra
put sugar into everything.
Yeah, that's crazy.
Yeah, they bake marshmallows on top and they get crispy. And yeah, that's good. I'm not knocking that. But sweet potatoes, most people only know them as dessert. Like sweet potato casserole, where they just load it with butter and marshmallows and like stuff that's not good for you. Whereas you can make them actually
butter.
Delicious.
Butter isn't bad for you.
The sugar is bad. Of course. And everything is fine in moderation, but I'm talking about dishes where it's like, okay, for this one sweet potato, you're going to need a whole stick of butter. Like stuff where it's clearly not good, you know?
The thing is that Americans put sugar into everything, which I dislike, especially something like sweet potatoes, which is already so sweet.
Yeah.
And whenever something is too sweet, by default, I get suspicious and I talk to AI like, hey, I made a sweet potato and it's super sweet. This isn't good for you, right? This can't possibly be healthy. Like, what is wrong here? What's going on? I did the same thing. I was also that suspicious of licorice root because I now like to put a little bit of licorice root in my teas because it's so almost excessively sweet.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's super sweet.
Should we wrap?
Sure.
Yeah, we can wrap.
Yeah, we should probably wrap.
I want to
Jackson, wrap. Do it.
Oh, wait, can I just ask real quick? Is there any way to make tomato good, though? Because I never
ketchup. You can just down ketchup if you really want tomato hits. No,
I just meant, like, as a vegetable on a, like, in a food.
You can grow up and start to like them.
Yeah, freshly sliced a tomato, put salt and pepper on it. That shit's good. It's tasty.
You're the douche that takes lettuce off his burgers.
I don't take lettuce off my burgers. If it comes on the burger, I keep it, but I usually ask for no lettuce if I can. Like if there's
that's so stupid. And
lettuce has no nutritional value whatsoever. Oh, like eating lettuce
is literally nothing.
Yeah.
It's great. No, it's the crunch.
I'm gonna give you a life hack that I've done that
God,
I fucking love.
The weakest
love.
Crunch of all time.
I'm gonna give you a life hack that I love. Every time lettuce comes up, switch it to spinach. That shit's good for you. Yep. It crunches all the same and it tastes good.
Even arugula.
Arugula's nice too, but I'm talking about like I love spinach salads, like regular salad with lettuce. If you eat salad with lettuce, you're wasting your time and you're an idiot. But if you get a salad and it's a spinach salad as the base, that shit is amazing. It's good for you. It's tasty. Try it out. I fucking love spinach. It's so good.
You could grow tomatoes too, Jackson. You can. I know. I've tried it different ways. You're just not like
I've tried tomato. No, I've tried it grilled. I've tried it like all the different ways in salads and stuff. Just never liked
you're
it.
You're just one of those forever children, I guess.
Yeah.
Yeah. I've tried.
To ketchup.
You'll never grow up, Jackson. You'll go to Wonderland.
Get your
it's
Happy
fine.
Meal and.
Yeah. Get your toy.
Ketchup packets in your mouth.
Open your My Little Pony and cry because you didn't get Rainbow Dash. You got another Twilight Sparkle. I saw you do that last week. I know.
Maybe. What if we melt marshmallow over it there?
Now you'll like tomatoes with melted marshmallow.
Could work. Yeah, could
That's
work.
That's disgusting.
All right. Thanks, guys. Thanks for hanging out. Patreon.com/theofficialpodcast to watch us get cucked live from Patreon. It's an exclusive video over there right now. Go check it out. All right. Thanks. We'll see you next time.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
That was a gross episode.